Welcome students to the first poem of Hornbill, a photograph by Shirley Thompson. Shirley Thompson is a poet who had written much emotional poems, and this is one of the poems where she was remembering her mother. Her mother passed away a long time back, and one day she came across a photograph of her mother when the mother was 12 years old. It was a very old photograph, and looking at the photograph, she realized many things. She's writing something about how she was missing her mother and how she felt when she looked at the photograph. The poem has been titled A Photograph, as she was looking at the photograph there. Let's begin this particular poem. The fourth line itself, the cardboard shows me how it was. She has used the word cardboard here instead of the word photograph. So we know that here the poetic device metaphor is there. Metaphor is where we understand that a particular word has been compared to something. So instead of the photograph here, the word cardboard has been used. So the poetic device metaphor is here. Now she was looking at the cardboard. So the cardboard shows me how it was. So it refers here to the past of the mother. She said after looking at the cardboard, after looking at the photograph, I understood how the past of my mother was. When the three girl cousins went paddling, all the three cousins, they went for a beach holiday, and it was there that they were just standing close to each other, holding hands of each other, and one person was clicking the particular photograph there. So now the poetess says that the three girl cousins went paddling, each one holding one of my mother's hands. That means the mother was standing in the middle, the two girl cousins were standing on the side, and all three of them were holding hands. Then she realized the mother that time was a big girl, some 12 years or so. You can see as you keep the book open in front of you. My mother, she was 12 years old that time, she says this. And the next thing she says, all three of them stood still. The girls were told that the photograph is being clicked. So all three of them were standing still. Because of the particular wind, what happened, the hair were coming on their face, but they were not trying to remove that. The reason was that they did not want to spoil the photograph. So all three of them were smiling through their hair at the uncle who was trying to click the photograph. At the uncle with the camera, you can see that line over there. Now the poetess, after looking at the photograph, realized that something had changed in the front, but nothing had changed in the background. So see the next line which has been mentioned over here. That is, the sea at the back did not change much. Okay, the sea at the back did not change much, but that sea washed their terribly transient feet. That is written here. It's written, and the sea which appears to have changed less washed their terribly transient feet. Students, terribly transient feet. Which device has been used here? One device which I told you is the repetition of sound, and that is alliteration over here. The sound term has been repeated. Terribly transient feet. One more meaning that comes up. It's an example of transport epithet also. Transport epithet, I told you that this particular case that has happened here is terribly, it is showing that yes, the human beings keep on changing. Transient means something that keeps on changing. And here the feet have been called transient. That means the feet keep on changing. And terribly associated here means that this change is very fast. The human beings don't realize unless and until there is a considerable change. Like students, as people grow up, they find that their shoes have become smaller. They say my shoes have become smaller. Actually, it's not so. The feet have become longer. Now in this case, people grow. So actually the feet also grow. So in this case, the feet keep on changing, and this change is so fast, that's why it has been called terrible. So terribly transient feet, one meaning is this. The next meaning that is there is that the feet have been called transient as compared to the sea at the background. The sea is permanent. The feet are transitory. They keep on changing. That's why they have been called transient feet. This is the best example of transport epithet over here. That means the meaning that comes clear cut is that the feet keep on changing. But the one more meaning which we can draw is that human beings' life, their life is mortal. They are mortal. Their life is temporary. It keeps on changing, and the sea at the background did not change much. Now here is when the poetess was looking at the photograph, she recalled all these things, that her mother was 12 years old, her face was very sweet, all three of them were standing still, three of them were holding hands, and the sea in the background did not change, but the human beings in the picture changed. Now the second paragraph that is there is, some 20-30 years later, she would laugh at the snapshot. The daughter remembered that when my mother used to look at the photograph, she used to always have a smile on the face. Same case is with us. When we have a look at the photograph of our past, then in that case, we also have the same feeling. It brings a smile on the face. The same thing happened here. The mother used to laugh at the photograph, and then the daughter remembered. Her mother used to say something. She said, "See Betty and Dolly and how they dresses for the beach." That means the names of the two cousins were Betty and Dolly, and she used to laugh the way they had dressed them for the beach. That means completely they had made the girls believe that yes, you're going for the beach. They had made them dress specially, and she used to laugh at that particular memory. So this particular memory is a past of the poetess's mother. Her past is what? Her photograph. But there is one more past which has been mentioned here. That past is of the poetess. So I will make it very clear in this particular case. There are two pasts being mentioned here. One is of the poetess and one is of her mother. What is the past of the mother? That was her memory when she went for a sea holiday. That is her memory. That was her past. The poetess's past was the laughter of the mother. There are two pasts being talked about in this particular poem. The past of the mother, that was her sea holiday. And the past of the poetess is the memory when the mother used to look at the photograph and she used to laugh, see how they dressed us for the beach. This particular thing has been mentioned here. Now here the poetess has mentioned something. The sea holiday was her past, mine is her laughter. The sea holiday was the past of the mother, mine, my past, that means the past of the poetess, is her laughter. The laughter on looking at her old memory. Now see the next line, both wry. Wry means there is a word which means distorted. In Hindi we say dhundla hona, that means with time it gets faded. So both the past, here these both past have become distorted with time. How have they become distorted with time? Of course, the mother is no more. So her past, of course, has faded away. But the daughter's past on the laughter, like the daughter's past on looking at the laughter of the mother, that also has become distorted with time because now the mother is no more. So both the past, both the past have become dry. They have become distorted, tundlaona, with time. And with the labored ease of loss, the best example of oxymoron here, oxymoron where two opposite words have been used here, labor with effort, ease something which is so easy. Now understand the whole meaning of this particular expression. Let's begin from here and then we'll move towards here. Loss was the loss of the mother. Students, it is said that when people die, what do the other people do? In order to that their life moves on, they try to forget that person. Is it easy? It requires efforts. And some people say that these efforts can't be made, it is very tough. But on the contrary, the poetess says that the effort is not so tough. The efforts we make, but these efforts can be made easily. We make easy efforts. And that is why, students, after some time you can understand that the person who has lost somebody, after some time the memory associated with those persons also become distorted. So this is the complete meaning of this particular expression. Loss is the loss of a person, death of a person. Do we require efforts in forgetting that person? Yes. Are these efforts tough? They are easy. So the poetess says that both the past have become distorted with the labor ease of loss. I gave efforts. After giving those efforts, the memories associated with the mother became distorted. And why did the memories come up that day? Because she was looking at the photograph of her mother. Now let us see the last stanza that is there. Now she is being dead nearly as many years as that girl lived. That means many years have passed to that mother, to the mother's death. And of this circumstance refers to the death of the mother. And of this circumstance, there is nothing to say at all. In what words can a daughter say something about her mother's death? She says of this circumstance, there is nothing to say at all. I have no words to express about my mother's death, about the sorrow that I felt over my mother's death, and now the sorrow that I'm feeling after looking at the photograph. She says, I have no words to describe that sorrow. The whole poem is so full of emotions of a daughter who has lost the mother. And she says, and of this circumstance, there is nothing to say at all. She has no words to describe the sorrow. She has no words to describe her mother's death. She has no words to describe her emotions now. Although she has written so well, but still she says, I have no words. There is nothing to say at all. And see the last very good lines that are there. It's silence, silences. Here also you can find there is an alliteration. It's silence, silences. It's here refers to the mother's death. This has brought a silence in the poetess's life. And this silence has made the poetess silent. Here you find there are two words. It's an example of repetition also. But at the same time you find these two words have got a little bit different meaning. Why little bit different? The death of the mother has brought a silence in her life. There is a void, there is a vacuum in her life. There is an emptiness, there is a lacuna. And that emptiness can never be filled up. Students, for children, if they lose their parents, it can never happen that that gap can be filled anytime. Nobody can fill that gap. So the death of the mother brought a silence in her life. And this silence has made the poetess silent. She has no words to express the death of her mother, to express the sorrow over her mother's death. So for a quick revision, all the poetic devices have been mentioned here. Cardboard, the poetic device is metaphor. Terribly transient feet, the poetic device here in this case is transport epithet, at the same time alliteration. Labor, ease of loss, in this particular case there is an oxymoron. This particular case is an oxymoron. And this is the best example of transport epithets. Transport epithet. And in this particular case, it's silence, silences. There is an example of alliteration. There is an example of repetition. It refers to the mother's death, which has brought a silence in her life. And this silence has made the poetess silent. Now I think so the whole poem is very clear to you. In this poem, the daughter expresses the sorrow of her mother's death. And at the same time, her feelings which came up when she saw that photograph where her mother was there. Thank you.